All right, good evening, everyone. Thanks for tuning in to our Wednesday night Bible study prayer time. It's kind of more of a Bible study since we've been in the virus shutdown mode, and so I'm glad that you've tuned in. We have 29 people that have tuned in so far tonight, and that's great. So I've always said that the Wednesday night services are the most important services because we spend time praying. And the heart of a church is prayer. That's where the power of the church comes from. If a church doesn't pray, the church has no power, and you see very little happening in those type of churches. No evangelism, really no Bible study. So we need to become a people of prayer because the world needs us. And the Bible tells us that we're involved in a great conflict, a war, and we fight against Satan, the world, the flesh, and the devil. We can have victory over those things because we already have victory in Christ. We just need to let Him live His life through us, and I think we'll be very victorious as a church. And so, thanks for tuning in tonight. We still stuck at 29. Let's hope we get 30. Yeah, we got 30. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. This is great. I love this. Let me give you a couple of prayer requests. I haven't been getting as many prayer requests from people here in the last couple of weeks, but let me give you a couple that I do know about. Brenda Newsom had fallen down recently and broke her collarbone. She went to Winston-Salem, that's wrong, but that'll work. Yeah, Winston-Salem, to have her collarbone maybe to look at for surgery, but she will not have to have surgery, so we thank God for that. And her son Michael, yesterday, went ahead and had surgery for a cancerous mass in his colon, and this is his third cancer operation. So be praying for Michael as he recovers from that. We don't know a whole lot about where he's at and how the surgery went, but be praying for them. And also, there's a little lady by the name of Olivia Lyall, L-Y-A-L-L. She's 4 years old, and she has two masses on her liver, and so we need to be praying for her. That was Olivia Lyall, L-Y-A-L-L. And my newest grandchild, Eliza Ruth Dillon, was born last Monday, so she's a week and 2 days old. And she's doing really well. But my daughter-in-law, Ellen, isn't doing very well. Her toes had turned purple, and she was in all kinds of pain with those. And so they took her to her doctor for a normal Monday, a week later checkup. And they sent her right away to Charleston Memorial. And she's been in the heart wing of the hospital for the last few days while they ran all kinds of tests on her to find out what's wrong. They did find out that she has a hole in her heart that might have been a congestive defect since birth. And part of her heart is enlarged, and they think that the toe problem, which is causing her excruciating pain, is having to do something through childbirth, and so they're going to be looking at that. And so sometime in the future, she'll have to have open-heart surgery to correct the hole in her heart. My daughter Bethany was born with a hole in her heart, but it closed up, and praise God for that. She didn't have to have any further treatments. And so be praying for Ellen and Patrick. He's been living in the parking lot there at Memorial because they won't let you in the hospital. And so he's had the baby in the car. He's been spending some night with some people down there. Sometimes he spends the night there at the barracks at the State Highway Patrol. So just pray for them that things go well. Pray for me too because I have Liam. Cindy and I have Liam. And he's a handful, but he's a lot of fun. And so be praying for them as they recover from where they're at. And so, before we get any further, I would like to play a song that's been given to us. It's by Keith and Christian Getty, and the name of the song is By Faith. And so, Gary's going to cue that up just in a minute, and we're going to listen to it.
Thank you. be moved. And the power of the gospel shall prevail. For we know in Christ all things are possible. For all who call upon His name, we will stand as children of promise. We will fix our eyes on Him, our soul's reward. Till the race is finished and the work is done, we walk by faith and not by sight.
I like that song. That song was picked out especially for us by Debbie Green. So Debbie, I just told the whole world that you picked out that song, and so it's a good one. So we thank you for that. Have your Bibles. I want you to go to the book of Isaiah. We're going to be there in a little while with the book of Isaiah. And so Isaiah chapter 42 is where we need to go to tonight. We have been looking at the idea of being a disciple of Jesus. What does it mean to be a disciple of Jesus? And one of the things that we have talked about is that there is no difference between being a believer of Jesus Christ and being a disciple of Jesus Christ. Sometimes people want to make a difference, like a disciple is a higher plane Christian, and that's not true. The word disciple comes from a Greek word that means learner. And so all of us have been learning from the moment we accepted Christ as our Savior, for me, until now. And that's been a long time. And so even though I'm the pastor of the church, I'm still learning. I'm still learning as a disciple of Jesus, and so are you. It's just that we each grow at different rates. I've seen some young people that would put me to shame on what they know because they just have the ability to do that. But there are certain things that are true if you are a born-again child of God, if you are a disciple of Jesus. It says in the Bible, if you go to Matthew chapter 28, where the Great Commission is given to us, Jesus says, "All authority has been given unto me in heaven and in earth." Jesus has all authority. And because of that, he says, "Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, I'm with you always, even until the end of the world," or the end of the age. And so we're to be going out into the world for the purpose of making disciples. And as we make disciples, we teach them. What do we teach them? Our own thoughts? Our own views? No. Jesus said, "You teach them whatsoever I have commanded you." You know, for 2,000 years, there's been things taught in churches, as believers have taught other believers. So how do you know what's right and what's wrong? We can praise God that we have the Word of God, and for 2,000 years, our sole authority has been the Word of God. I pastor a Baptist church because I believe that this is as close as we can get to a New Testament church, because I believe the doctrine of the Bible seems to be very Baptistic. And we have looked at that in the past at our church, looking at the distinctives that make us who we are. And so we go back to the book. We are people of the book. Not what so-and-so says, or what this person says or preaches, or what we've been taught over the years by this man or that man. We don't follow men. We follow the Scriptures. We follow God. And as men preach the Word, then we follow them. But when they don't preach the Word, then we don't follow them anymore. We are people of the book. And the book tells us that a disciple is a person who is learning about the things that Jesus has commanded them. And last week, we were looking at the idea of lordship. And that's a word today that really people are taken back at. People don't want to be considered, you know, that I have to have somebody lord over me. But as a child of God, you gave up your life the moment you accepted Christ as your Savior. You were crucified with Christ. Crucifixion brings death. But even though it brings death, it brings us, through Christ, abundant life. And so we are willing to give up our life for Christ. And as we do that, we realize that all authority has been given unto Him in heaven and in earth. He is sole authority, and we follow Him. Many times people will say, well, I'll accept Jesus as my Savior, but I don't always have to obey the things that He tells us to do. That seems kind of ludicrous, doesn't it? You can't take Jesus and divide Him up. In other words, you accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. Amen? That's how that works. The Lord, that tells you who He is. He is God Almighty. That's who He is. He opened the corridor of time and came into our world in order to die on that cross to give us eternal life. That should excite us. He is our Lord. He did that for me. I had no hope. There was no hope for me whatsoever till Jesus did that for me. He's my Lord. I'm willing to follow Him. People have taught me the commandments of the Lord. And I hear them, and because they're His commandments, I have a desire to follow them. Because I love the Lord. And Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. Now let's pause there for a moment. Do we love Jesus all the time? Well, sure we do. Do we obey Him all the time? Sure we don't. But we have that desire to obey Him. You know, we still have a sin nature that we deal with all the time. A sin nature that wants to pull us away from God, pull us away from His commandments, pull us away from what He desires us to do. And so there's always a constant tug of war in our life between the old nature and the new nature that Christ has given to us. And so as we spend time with the Lord, and He spends time with us, our new nature that's being discipled by the Lord Himself begins to grow stronger. And we begin to find ourselves obeying Him more than the old nature. Many people sometimes will say, well, you know, Pastor Tim, I can't live the Christian life. And that's true. You can't live the Christian life in the flesh. It just can't happen. But when you accept Christ as your Savior and the Holy Spirit comes up and in and takes up residence in your life, then through His power and by His grace, you can start having victory over the sin in your life. But as long as we're in this flesh, in this body, we're still going to wrestle with that all the time. There's no perfect people. I'm not perfect. Billy Graham wasn't perfect. And any other preacher you can possibly think of aren't perfect people, because we're people. And the Bible says that we are sinners. We have a sin nature. And just because I got saved doesn't mean that I got rid of the sin nature. It's still here with me. And so when we talk about the lordship of Christ, we're talking about this idea of giving ourselves to our Master and obeying Him. You know, we looked at just a couple of things last week. As far as lordship goes, we need to have full surrender to His authority in our life. There's times that we have to sit down and think, where am I in relationship to the Lord? Am I obedient in the things that He tells me to do? Am I obedient in my prayer life? If most of us were being honest, the answer is no, we're not being faithful in our prayer life. Our prayer life suffers. That's like our services usually on Wednesday night are the worst attended service, and that's not just our church, that's every church. And I've said that so many times over the years because it's true. He tells us to pray without ceasing, to pray always, because our prayers can make a difference. We have an opportunity to stand in the gap for people who need us to stand in the gap. And that means that our lives need to be right. The Bible says if you have iniquity in your heart, God won't hear you. And, you know, for my daughter-in-law who needed people to be praying for her over what she was happening, we didn't know, but we needed people that were right with the Lord, that God was going to hear. And that's true in your life, too. You think about the people in your life that are sick, maybe sick unto death, or maybe you don't know, you're not really worried about them. Wouldn't it be great to know that you have the ear of the Creator of all things, that He desires to hear what it is that you have to say? I think that's important. And so you have to ask yourself, are you and have you fully submitted to His authority in your life? Praying, reading the Bible. You know, we've had weeks and weeks where people have been home. Have you read any of the Bible? Have you studied any of the Bible? Have you gone to our website and looked up those studies that we have? Because they're not there just to make a pretty website. They're there for us to grow and understand. Because someday, you and I are going to stand before the Lord. It could be sooner or it could be later. I don't know. You don't know. But there is a divine appointment that's coming someday for all of us. And we need to be ready. We need to grow as disciples to become what God wants us to be. And so we have full submission to His authority. Last week also we talked about to recognize that He owns us. You know, people don't like that. You know, we were talking about a moment ago this idea of our society doesn't like authority. You know, in the last, say, 10 years, look how the police have been treated in our country. You know, they're an authority figure. Even when I was a policeman, they weren't treated very well. It's a lot worse today than it was then. But Jesus owns us, you know. He is our authority, and He owns us. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 6 that we were bought with a price. What was the price? Well, the price was that Jesus came into this world as the God-man and died on the cross, and the Father poured out upon Him all the wrath that was due mankind since the beginning of time till the end of time. And Jesus paid a debt He didn't owe, but He paid it in full. He paid it in full. And so because He paid it in full, and when I place my faith and trust in Him, I'm giving up ownership of my life to Him. He owns me. It's not my choice anymore. It's His choice. And so I should ask, when I ask anything, Lord, what would You have me to do? Remember years ago, what would Jesus do? Well, I think those things are still pertinent today. What would Jesus do? What would the Lord have me to do in this area, in that area? Because He owns me. I'm His servant, and that word servant literally means slave. And again, we surely don't want to talk about being slaves in America, but that's exactly what we are. I am a slave to Christ, and I am not ashamed to say it. I no longer own myself. I place myself into submission to Him as my owner. He owns me. And so last week we talked about full submission to His authority, recognition of His ownership. And then lastly, we talked about this idea of unquestioned obedience. And I worked into that concept the idea of absolute surrender. And there are things in your life and things in my life that we just haven't gotten rid of yet. Things that get in our way, spiritually speaking. Things that slow us down, spiritually speaking. And we have to give those things up to God. And we need to let the Holy Spirit have rule in our life, in every aspect of our life. That's absolute surrender. That's unquestioned obedience. Because He says it, and He's my ultimate authority, I will do it. And so the Lordship of Christ is important. The Lord, Jesus was His human name. Christ was His title as the Messiah. And so He's my Lord. He's my Messiah. He's my Jesus. And if you're a disciple, He's your Lord and you will obey Him. And so today I want to talk about just another idea. And that is the idea about being a servant of God. You know, God saved us for a purpose. You know, Ephesians chapter 2, 8, 9, and 10, they tell us, you know, that we're saved by grace through faith, right? And so it tells us, but we are His workmanship, it says in verse 10, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which He hath before ordained that we should walk in them. God saved us for a purpose, and that purpose is to serve Him. Think about this now. Jesus didn't hang around after His ascension, after He, you know, told His disciples, you go into all the world and you preach the gospel, you make disciples, you teach them everything I've taught you. He left. He entrusted that to them, who entrusted that to their disciples, and on and on and on to today. We have become His servants. And for things to be accomplished for the Lord today, it's up to His servants to do that. And so in the Bible, the word servant of the Lord is used really three different ways. In Isaiah chapter 41, if you have your Bibles there in Isaiah, just go ahead and look at verses 8 and 9. Because it talks about the nation of Israel being a servant of the Lord. It says, "But you, Israel, are my servant, Jacob, whom I have chosen, the descendants of Abraham, my friend. You whom I have taken from the ends of the earth and called from his farthest regions and said to you, you are my servant, I have chosen you and have not cast you away." And so Israel is called a servant of the Lord. But in Isaiah chapter 54, verse 17, the Bible says, "This is a heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is from me, says the Lord." And there, the idea of being a servant is applied to his children. Are you a child of God? You have his righteousness? We're his servants. He saved us for a purpose. You know, people live in this world today and they go through life and they look back at their life and realize that they haven't really accomplished anything. Because if we just do worldly things, we really don't accomplish anything. It's what we do for the Lord that smacks through eternity. So what are you doing for the Lord? And so it's used of the nation of Israel. It's also used of the children of God. But also it's used of the Messiah. In Isaiah chapter 42, verse 1, the Bible says, "Behold, my servant whom I uphold, my elect one in whom my soul delights, I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the Gentiles." And so if we look at the first couple verses here of Isaiah chapter 42, we're going to see some qualities, some characteristics that are involved in servanthood today. In Isaiah 42, he's talking about the servant. He's talking about the Messiah. And that would be Jesus. And Jesus was a servant of the Lord, just like we are servants of the Lord. Think about this. You know, the last night that Jesus spent with his disciples before he was crucified, he sat down with them in the upper room, and then he washed their feet. He taught his disciples servanthood. And in John chapter 13, verses 15 through 16, this is what the Bible says. It says, "For I have given you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than he who sent him." And so Jesus is trying to teach us a little bit about servanthood. And that needs to be the attitude and the pattern of disciples today. He's our example. Well, what is Jesus our example in? Well, the Bible gives us two places that Jesus is our example. The first one I just read to you there in John 13. He's our example as servants of the Lord. He's our example in our service. But also, he's our example in suffering. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 21, the Bible says, "For to this you were called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow in his steps." And so God saved us to serve him, but God also saved us that we may have to suffer. And we've talked about that before when we talked about qualities and characteristics of a disciple. That you, every day, have to take up your cross and follow Jesus. And taking up your cross is the concept of suffering. And really, in America today, I don't think we really have a good handle on this idea of suffering. Because really, we don't suffer much for the Lord. You know, really, when we think about suffering, we think about sickness and that sort of thing. But this isn't what it's talking about. It's going out there and preaching Jesus to people who spit at you, who throw rocks at you, who want to cut your head off, who want to destroy you and your wife and your children. That's a person who's being persecuted for his faith. And Jesus said, "Hey, don't worry about it. I've overcome the world. Don't worry about him who can destroy the body. Worry about him who can destroy the soul and the spirit and cast it into hellfire." And so Jesus is teaching us to serve. He washed his disciples' feet to teach them how to serve. And so here in John chapter 13, he gives us a revelation of servanthood. And let me just say this, it's not a new concept for God. You know, Jesus walked the earth. He's God. He's the same today, yesterday, and forever. God never changes. And so when he stepped out of eternity into time, he didn't change. He was a servant then. He's a servant now. He only manifested in time what he has always been in eternity, and that's a servant. And so Jesus brought out these massive servant principles for his disciples to serve the Lord. And so our normal usage of the word servant has a negative connotation to it. But Jesus equated servanthood, now get this, he equated servanthood with greatness. To serve God is what makes you great. Sometimes when I do a funeral, I ask people, what made this person successful? What made that person successful? And there's three thoughts in my mind. You love your family. I mean, really love your family with an agape love. You love your family. What else do you love? You love your country. We are so blessed to be in this country, and this country is in trouble. This is just a foreshadowing of things to come. But also, not just to love our country, we're to love our God. And how are we to love our God? The Bible says we're to love Him with our full heart, soul, mind, and strength. All that we have, we love Him. Is that true in your life? That's called absolute surrender. That's what it has to be. And so, Jesus said in Mark chapter 10, "But whoever desires to become great among you shall be your servant." See, that just goes against the grain of our culture today. "And whoever of you desires to be first shall be a slave to all." So, let's go back to Isaiah 42. That's all introduction. And I want to look at six principles in the Lord's life as the Messiah that we see in Isaiah 42 that need to be reproduced in your life and in my life, the lives of His disciples today. They're not real complicated and it won't take very long, but I just jot them down if you would, because I think they're important for you to meditate on these things and say, hey, is this true in my life? You should have been doing that through all the other videos we've been doing. This is, I think, our fourth video on discipleship. And so you can find them on our website, and you should go back and watch those. And so the first one is in the first part of verse 1 of Isaiah chapter 42. It says, "Behold, my servant whom I uphold." Now, I think that's an amazing concept. If you realize that Jesus was God who stepped out of time into eternity, you know, He emptied Himself at the incarnation of His outward manifestations of glory. But He didn't divest Himself of His deity at all. His divine attributes were all there. But He did empty Himself of something. What was it? He emptied Himself of His own self-will and self-sufficiency. What's unique about Jesus is that everything He did it in tune with what the Father commanded Him to do. Think about this. Now, Jesus, it says He upholds in Hebrews. He upholds everything by the word of His power. In Colossians, the same thing. But here, when He became a man, He needed divine upholding. Look at that verse again. "Behold, my servant whom I," what? "Uphold." God is upholding His servant. In this case, it's Jesus. After Jesus, it's who? It's you and me. John chapter 5, verse 19, the Bible says, "The Son can do nothing of Himself but what He sees the Father do. Whatever He does, the Son also does in like manner." Jesus emptied Himself of self-sufficiency. And He placed Himself under the authority of another, His Father. John chapter 7, verse 16, He says, "My doctrine is not mine, but Him who sent me." What's that tell you? Jesus placed Himself in submission to His Father. He spoke the words that His Father told Him to say. He preached the words that His Father told Him to preach. Let me give you one more verse. John chapter 4, verse 24. "He who does not love me does not keep my words, and the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father who sent me." Jesus was always in submission to His Father, always in submission to His authority. And so these verses teach us that Jesus chose to be dependent of His Father. No. Was He independent of the Father? No. He was dependent on the Father for all of His words and all of His works that He did. And you think, kind of a paradox. He, you know, is the incarnation of God Almighty. But still, He had to be upheld by His Father while He did His earthly ministry. If Jesus had to be upheld to perform His earthly ministry, how much more do we need to be upheld to perform ours? And that's part of the problem that we have. We try to do everything in our own power. We were, Pete Sawchuck and I were over at my daughter's house doing some work on some piping, and he was having some trouble getting the thing off. And I was really proud of him because he didn't lose his sanctification not one time. And I was really proud of that. So I got to watch him, probably because the preacher was there watching him. But, you know, it's difficult. And I asked him, I said, did you pray? And he just kind of looked at me and smiled. And I said, well, I've been praying for you because I was watching, trying to get that thing off. But that's how we do it, not to pick on Pete, because we're all the same way. We jump into things and we do things without ever giving a thought to God, because prayer is not as paramount as it needs to be in our life. It needs to be paramount in our life. And it doesn't matter how small it is. We need to have that communication with God, because eternal life is having a personal, intimate relationship with God. And when you have a personal, intimate relationship with somebody, you talk with them. You share with them. And that's what Jesus wants us to do. And then finally, Jesus made himself in the very nature of a servant in Philippians chapter 2. Starting in verse 5, the Bible says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider it to be robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant or a slave, and becoming and coming in the likeness of men. Jesus became a servant. And so there we have an aspect of dependence on God. He said, Tim, we've kind of talked about that before. Isn't it neat how you go back and look at different things in the Scripture and you find them repeated and maybe in a different way? And you see it, you know, it's taken this way and it's turned up this way, and there it is again. You just can't seem to shake it. So often people will say, you know, Pastor, it was so funny when you preached today, our Sunday school lesson went right with that. That's because the Bible is so interconnected. It's interconnected so we can see these things, that they keep coming up, because God is trying to teach us the things that he's commanded us. And so that's the first one, dependence. The second one is found in the second part of verse 1, and that's acceptance. So we have dependence and we have acceptance. It says, my elect one in whom my soul delights. I said that the title servant of the Lord was given to Israel. That was a nation that God chose by his grace. He established his presence with those people, and those people disappointed him year after year after year. Till finally, Jerusalem was destroyed. The Jews were just dispersed all over the Roman Empire, and they only came back in about 1948. Think about that. And so I think the father was many times disappointed with his servant of the Lord Israel. But here, look what it says, my elect one. And here he's talking about the Messiah, as we talked about earlier, my Messiah. My elect one in whom my soul, what? Delights. The very essence of God delights where? Delights in the Messiah. He's not disappointed with the Messiah. I find two occasions in the Bible where the Father broke the silence of eternity and spoke openly of his approval for his son, for his Messiah. In Matthew chapter 3, verse 17, the Bible says, and suddenly a voice came from heaven saying, this is my beloved son in whom I am, what? Well pleased. So, you know, this is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. And he wants the whole world to know, this is my beloved son. He's very pleasing to me. Let me just pause there a minute and ask you, are you pleasing to him? So, well, that's talking about the Lord. I know it's talking about the Lord. But you, as a child of God, are also a servant of God, a servant of the Lord. He gave us two examples. One was serving and the other was suffering. And so ask yourself, is the Lord pleased with me? Is the Lord pleased with my spiritual life? You know, since I've been at Daniel's, I've done several funerals for people. And it was always on my mind, were they ready? Were they ready? I don't know. What makes you ready? I would suggest to you a lifetime makes it ready. A lifetime of walking with the Lord. So when that time comes, people know exactly where you stood with God. They know exactly where you are. No fear, this excitement and this people praising God, being exuberant over the fact that you're no longer suffering in this world. You've been set free from the bonds of this earthly place, and now you're walking in the fields with your Heavenly Father. I mean, how do you comprehend that? That's a person who is delighting in the Lord. in Matthew chapter 17, verse 5, on the Mount of Transfiguration, there again, we have another time when God spoke out of eternity into time to talk about this one that he delighted in. It says, while he was still speaking, this is verse 5 of Matthew chapter 17, while he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and suddenly a voice came out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Wow. Hear him. Hear him. Isn't that true of our lives? If we're walking in the right way, talking in the right way, people are going to listen to what we have to say. Because they're going to sense in you and in me the presence of God. And he is present in our life. And he delights in that. He delights in that. And so we talked about acceptance. We talked about dependence. Let me give you the third one. Self-effacement. Self-effacement. What does that mean? Well, it's not all about you. That's what that means. You know, you don't want to be the star of the party. You know, you just want to kind of slide in and slide out. Nobody's ever going to know you're there. That's what the idea. It says in verse 2 of Isaiah chapter 42, he will not cry out, nor raise his voice, nor cause his voice to be heard in the street. Why? Because he takes a low-key life. You know, Jesus healed the sick, raised the dead. You know, they wanted to make him king. What did he do? He left. He healed people, and he said, shh, don't tell anybody. Sometimes he didn't tell them who he was. He just did it. I found one rendering of verse 2 that says this, he will not be loud and screamy. You know, you think about screamy, you think about our society today, especially films and stuff. The louder the better, seems like, is what you find today. But this is speaking of the ministry of the Lord. The ministry of God's servant would not be flamboyant, but it would be modest and self-effacing. It really runs the opposite of what we see in our society today. It's not all about us. You know, when I accepted Christ as my Savior, I gave up my life for Jesus. Haven't you? That's just how it is. He performed miracles. He did all these wonderful things, but he never really took the credit for it. Never did. Self-effacement. And as our example, as servants of the Lord, it's not all about you. It's not all about me. It's all about Jesus. It's all about our serving Jesus, serving our Master. And so we talked about dependence and acceptance and self-effacement. Let me give you number four. There's only six. This is number four. Empathy. Not apathy, but empathy. We have a lot of apathy in our society today. We just don't really care. That's apathy. But empathy means that you do care. Look at verse 3. A bruised reed he will not break, and smoking flax he will not quench. You know, I've always heard it said that the church is the only army that shoots its own wounded. And there may be some truth to that, actually. But it says, a bruised reed he will not break. He will not break. He takes care of it. That's how we are, servants of the Lord. We put our arms around, not now, we put our arms around people and we just draw them to ourselves to give them encouragement, to give them strength, to show them we care, to show them that we love them. We show them empathy. We show them that they're special to us, not apathy. Empathy. Jesus showed empathy all the time. We need to show the same thing because he's our example. And so that's the fourth one. The fifth one is optimism. Look at verse 4. He will not fail nor be discouraged till he has established justice on the earth. You see those two words, fail and discouraged? If you go back to verse 3, the word break and the word quench, they're the exact same words in Hebrew, the exact same words. Fail and break, discourage and quench. Not discouraged. No. He will not fail, nor will he be discouraged. You know, when we think about doing something in the church, I will not fail. I'm setting my hand to the plow, and I'm going to accomplish something for the Lord. There is no going back. This is what we're going to do. When I decided to become, to pursue the ministry, I left my job at the police department, and I stepped out in faith into the unknown, and there was no going back. There was only going forward. I was going to serve God for the rest of my life. And that's not anything special about me. This is how it should be for all of us. For all of us. Yeah, there's been a lot of setbacks, a lot of difficult things, sometimes a lot of bad things from good people happen to you. But you don't get discouraged. You don't fail. You don't fall. You get back up and you move forward because you have something to accomplish, not for you, but for Jesus. And so you're optimistic. I joke around sometimes saying I'm a pessimist with optimistic views. And maybe the longer you're in the ministry, you get that way. But I would like to say that if I was really going to be honest with myself and quit trying to be funny, I would say I am an optimist. I'm an optimist because I think people can do things. Things can happen if God's people rise up. We should be optimistic about our servant, about being servants of the Lord and our serving the Lord. Am I optimistic about what's happening in this country? No, I'm not optimistic about what's happening in this country. We lost our moral compass. We've killed millions and millions of babies and nobody says a word. We're so far into debt, we'll never see the top of the hole. This country is in massive, massive trouble. But we go on like life goes on. You see, I don't know what's going to happen in the future with America. But I know that God has called us to be faithful as servants. And we need to go about what He's called us to do with optimistic views. He will not fail. And I will not be discouraged. And then there's one more. So I've talked about dependence. I've talked about acceptance. I've talked about self-effacing. I've talked about empathy. And I talked about optimism. And that is one more. And that's the anointing. Look at verse number 1 again, the last part of verse number 1. It says, I have put my spirit where? Upon him. I think sometimes in our churches today, we try to do so much without the power of the Holy Spirit. Carl Johnson always said that he thought most people in churches weren't really born again to begin with. Maybe there's some truth to that. When I see Carl, I ask him someday in the future. But you think about it. I can't do anything without the Lord. He's my sole authority. I answer to Him. He tells me what to do and I go do it. And I should not be discouraged. I'm not going to fail. Be optimistic because I serve a great God. And everything He wants me to accomplish, everything He wants me to do, I can do it. He doesn't ask me to do things I can't do. But He gives me the power and the strength to do the things that He wants me to do. He gives me His anointing. He gives me His power. He told the disciples, you know, when they knew He had risen from the dead, now don't go out and preach anything. You go to Jerusalem and you wait until you are given power from on high, until the Holy Spirit comes. Because in the Holy Spirit is where our power comes from. So everything we do needs to be Holy Spirit bathed. Everything we do has to be thinking about what would God have us to do. We are called to be servants. Servants of the Lord. And so really we need a touch of the supernatural. I think we've kind of lost that in our Baptist churches. You know, we don't want to be charismatic and things like that. But yeah, there's an aspect of spiritualism in the church today. Because I'm 2/3 spiritual, 1/3 physical. This body is going to get laid aside someday, but Tim Dillon's not going to stop being Tim Dillon. This is how it works. God has supplied His servants with all they need. It says in Acts chapter 10:38, God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power. And really, He didn't do anything until He was anointed with power at His baptism. Same thing applies to us. We don't want to do anything unless we have His strength and power behind us. And so those are things that I want you to see here this evening. These are things that need to be manifesting themselves in your life and in my life, where people see us and they know who we are. We have that idea of dependence upon God, His acceptance. We want to please Him in all things. But we're not always that way, are we? No, we're not. We want to be self-effacing. It's not all about me. It's all about Him. Lift Him up. Show empathy, not apathy. If you don't have an answer for something, don't cause more problems. give an answer, not a problem. Be optimistic about serving God. Jesus is coming. Praise God, he's coming. And remember that we have received an anointing of the Spirit, and the Spirit is not given in measure. And we are prepared to serve him. Are you? Jesus is coming. This is a little bump in the road with this COVID-19 virus. But we're not done yet. When there's life, there's hope. There's work to be done, we do it. Because God told us to. Father, we thank you so much for the time that you've given to us tonight. We thank you for these opportunities that we've had to learn about who you are and what you expect of us as your disciples. And so, Lord, sometimes there's a cost to be paid as a disciple. Help us be willing to pay it. And Lord, we love you and we look forward to what you're going to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Try.